Sarah, yes. You're the co-founder of Deemly.
Yes.
We're here at your office at the Singularity Hub in Copenhagen.
Yes.
It's a really nice place. I'm looking forward how it will look like in a year, because they're quite busy with construction.
Yeah, there's builders all around, so you should come back in a year.
Yeah. And so you're the co-founder of Deemly.
Yes.
So what is it?
Yeah, so very short, we're a reputation and social verification startup, specifically targeted at sharing economy startups and peer-to-peer marketplaces. Essentially, our goal is to build trust for users in the sharing economy, and we do that by allowing users to take their reputation across platforms. So simple terms, we're a software solution to build trust.
Okay, and how did you came up with the idea?
Yeah, so 3 years ago, I wrote my thesis on the sharing economy, and I interviewed a number of startups around Europe and their founders, and they all said, well, our biggest issue is creating trust for our users, so how do we go about doing this? And at the same time, there were reports coming out from the US and Denmark and everywhere in Europe saying this is one of the major barriers for user growth and adaptation in the sharing economy. So it's sort of a two-sided problem that we really want to solve because we believe in the sharing economy.
And why did those reports say that it was a problem or a challenge?
Yeah, so I think the Danish report was saying 49% of Danes worry about taking part in the sharing economy, partly because they don't trust strangers, partly because tax legislation is unclear and so on. So there are lots of factors. But one of the main drivers of the sharing economy is that you trust the strangers that you share with or buy from or rent from or stay with or whatever. So those were quite big issues.
Yeah. And before we go into that, I already have 10 questions
yes,
to ask.
Yeah.
Can you also tell me, so how did you start us?
What do we do? Basically, we sort of started a landing page and tried to gain some interest just from that. But I think the main, and then I gathered my co-founders and who were also, two of them actually ran sharing economy platforms before that didn't really take off, so they were looking for something new. And the main thing that we did was to participate in something called Venture Cup, which is a business plan competition in Denmark, where we got to the finals. And from there on, we basically got PR, not only in Denmark, but also I wouldn't say globally, but in different countries, which also meant that we got investors interested in backing us. So that was a very short time span, and it just meant that okay, we'll take the money and then we'll run really fast and
take the money and run.
Yeah, sadly they keep following us. No, but that meant that we could get started really quickly and actually build the software, because it's not just an app; it's quite a heavy setup with a lot of API integrations and so on.
Yeah. And about finding your co-founders.
Yeah.
It sounds like a really thing that really happens really quick, but I think they're the most important stakeholders in your company.
Yes.
Besides the investors, and investors they will go and leave. So
yeah.
I think the co-founders is really important.
Yes.
So how did you make decision of which co-founder to trust and to keep on board?
Yeah. So all of the co-founders except for one I knew previously. The last one was referred to me by a very close friend. So in that sense, I had trust in them because I already knew them, or I trusted the person that had recommended them. And then, when you start out, you're not in a luxurious situation where you can just pick and choose. So it's also about who believes in the product and the idea, who actually has the time to go into this, and obviously, what skills do we need? And I was quite lucky to get these people on board and convince them that this is going to change the world. And I think luckily all of them still think that. Not everyone is active on the team anymore, but that's sort of a journey that I think any startup takes when you start up with several co-founders.
Yeah. And then you also found some investors. So how did you convince the investors with just an idea? It's also about trust.
Yes. I think So we were quite surprised that we had that much interest from investors that early on, because when we raised the first investment, we only had wireframes and an algorithm in progress.
Algorithm in progress, yeah. Sounds really cool.
Yeah, and but with the PR and the exposure that we got, we also got a number of customers or platforms that said, hey, we want to buy this product. So it was sort of showing initial traction, at least there's some interest. So I think that was one key element of it, that, okay, there's interest for the solution. But then what they said was that 80% of the reasoning behind putting in the investment this early was the team. So I think, you know, the fact that my co-founders has started sharing economy platforms, which would eventually be our customers, and then all the research and the network that I had was quite significant in terms of that, yeah.
Yeah. And then because you said there were also quite some platforms who were interested.
Mm-hmm.
What was the benefit? Because if you look at trust and sharing economy, it's also about building your reputation.
Yeah.
It's also for many platforms a really interesting login in the platform.
Yeah.
So many platforms when they start they are interested, but when they are growing,
yep,
they will lose interest. So
yeah.
So what was the motivation for the platform to say yes, I'm interested in your idea?
Sure. So I think there are three main value proposition. One is definitely the visionaries, the ones that understand this is the way the world is going to go, whether I want it to or not, whether it's a lock-in mechanism or not. So those are a sort of separate categories, and they were probably the first ones to say, yes, we want this. Then there is, you know, the smaller startups that are, they might not even have launched yet, or they're just getting started. And where they're saying, okay, well, we want to start, we have maybe a sign-up list, but none of the people on our platform have any reputation, right? No one has said, yes, you're an okay guy. So they can say, okay, well, everyone uses Airbnb, so if we can take the reputation from Airbnb, for example, and any other big platform, then at least it's a start to get started. So that alleviates that cold start issue that many early stage sharing economy platforms have. When you look at the sort of bigger or the growth startups, what we see is that many of them have issues with bias. So let's say 20%, there's usually this 80-20 divide in where 20% of the users are really, really active, and they're really, really active because they have good ratings as one of the key value adds,
yeah,
right? Where it's really hard for the 80% to get in to being active.
Yeah.
So if we can help these 80% that might not have any ratings or reviews convert them into active users, that's a huge financial benefit for platforms. And then obviously there's, you know, fraud detection, can we verify who the user is and so on. So there's a great number of value adds for the platforms. And it's a little different from where they are in their journey, what makes sense for them.
Yeah, and if you look to the 80-20,
mm-hmm,
the reputation might be one of the reasons why they don't why they're not active.
Mm-hmm.
But in the end, I think there will always be a big group, over 50% of people who are not of the biggest value of the platform, and always a smaller group of really active participants.
Yeah, sure. I agree with you there, and I think that's also what we say in terms of when people ask, okay, well, what if we have users with a bad rating? That might be maybe 2 or 5%, and in that sense, well, maybe you're just not interested in actually having them on your platform because they will actually be a high risk user for you, and they will destroy your community and the trust that you're trying to build.
Yeah.
And I think that's the same with the 50%. If they're not active, then why spend time on getting them active?
Yeah.
But there are definitely some that can be converted.
Yeah, because it depends on the platform, but I think most platforms, they want to focus their energy and money on the most active players, because you need them to be to create a reliable service for your demands.
Exactly, and I think a lot of the founders would rather have really a small group of really active, engaged, trusting users than, you know, 3 million users, but it's only maybe 5% that are actually going into book or rent or something, right?
It depends if you want to talk to the media or investors.
Yes, exactly.
It's different questions. Really good.
But then the activity level comes as the next question, at least with investors, right?
Yeah, with investors, with media, not so much.
Exactly, yeah.
And so how does your system work? Because there's I have quite some comments on the existing rating systems.
Yep.
Like when you look at Uber, the 5-star rating average is if you as a driver, when you come below 4.6, then you get banned by the platform.
Yep.
But also as a rider, as a client, when you are 4.3 or lower, then I think 50% of the drivers won't pick you up. That's what I see in all the Uber Facebook group discussions.
Yeah.
Like, I've got a client with a 4.4. No, just cancel, because 4.4 is trouble. So how do you measure trust in your system?
Sure. So we basically have two main products, but the one that you're sort of referring to here is what we call the Trust Profile API, where we allow users to gather the ratings that they have across platforms. The way we do it is anyone can go into our site and sign up and create their profile and build that. We do have a score from 1 to 100, which is an average. We also have started, which is sort of in an early beta phase, but we're analyzing the written reviews. So we can actually generate a score from based on what people are writing about you. And it's really interesting to see that, you know, you might have a 5-star review, but the written review you have a 5-star rating, and the written review, how that matches. And what we can see from the early detection on the data that we have is that people are generally more negative in the written reviews than the rating, right? So that's sort of a call to, at least for us, we can already say, well, it's a best principle to always have a written review with a numerical rating, because that's more truthful.
Yeah.
I think Uber is doing it now with, you can sort of pick words that also describe the trip. I don't know if that's enough. We will have to sort of see and analyze the data on that. But that's sort of one very early best principle to take from that.
And because you're aggregating from different sources the data,
Do
you also make differences in scores for skills or skills for being polite? Or I don't know, because in the end, the example that you hear most, the fact that I'm a good Airbnb host doesn't mean that I'm a good driver.
No, exactly. And I totally agree with that sentiment. But there is a lot of things surrounding that experience that is the same. So are you communicating well? Do you show up on time? Are you paying? Sometimes that's not an option. But there's a lot of things surrounding that transaction, no matter what it is that you're doing, that tells something about how you are as a person. And so our score is sort of made to be easy to understand and compare. But we always show, it is possible to always show how it's calculated, what's broken down into, and where the data comes from.
Yeah.
So that's really important for us also to be transparent in how we measure the aggregation. Yeah.
Yeah. So also on your website, you can also see how your measurements algorithm is working.
Yeah, they're not the exact algorithm. We also have investors that wouldn't like us to put that out there, but it's actually not very complicated. But it is detailed with where the data comes from, and we're constantly developing that, so it becomes more transparent.
Yeah. I think this transparency we really need, because we have no idea how scores on all the platforms. We have no idea which different data variables are put into the to the outcome.
Exactly, and that's also why sort of towards the other side of our product is a whole rating and review system. So if platforms don't already have that, or they want to change it, we want to build, you know, state-of-the-art rating systems and be a third party, so that the platforms, if they're worried about fake reviews or bias or data discrimination, we can sort of take on that responsibility and say, well, we're doing, you know, what the the foremost sharing economy platforms are doing, and we take the responsibility for actually making sure there are no fake reviews. So that's sort of where we're taking that part of the product right now.
And taking responsibility, or what does it mean?
No, I mean, I think it's a lot of the platforms are worried about how do we actually combat fake reviews and what happens if a user is unhappy and all these things. And at least one thing in terms of going into that conversation is saying, well, we're using Deemly, they have, you know, certified rating systems, and we're sure that their technology is better than what we could develop. So that's at least the first step in terms of of getting to a trustworthy platform, basically. Yeah.
Yeah. And from which data sources can you put data into your Deemly profile?
Yeah.
Because as a user can make a profile and then link to some different social media accounts. How does it work?
Yes. Yeah, so the social media accounts we use to verify you. So that doesn't actually go into the algorithm, but that's the standard Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, your Gmail, But the actual numerical ratings or reviews that you have across platforms, right now we pull from Airbnb, from eBay, Upwork, Etsy just got on, HomeAway. We're negotiating with both BlaBlaCar and Uber at the moment. And we see a lot more of the platforms sort of opening up, especially the bigger ones. And then naturally, all of the platforms that are using our API and rating system also feeds back data to us. So there's a few Dutch platforms now coming on board. So we're hoping to create this network effect of platforms.
Yeah. So, and what is the benefit for like a BlaBlaCar or a Uber to open up for Deemly?
As a company, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. So what we see, what's driving this change is two things. So one thing is, and I spoke to Airbnb about this as well. They're saying we have so much data, but we have no idea what it tells us and how we're going to put it into play and what we can use it for. So we want to open it up so other entrepreneurs can actually use it and find the value in our data. So it's sort of an engineering approach. Then the second one is that the EU and the Federal Trade Commission in the US are saying, you guys are growing so big, so you should actually open it up for your data, so we know and understand more about this industry and your users. So there's also sort of a legislative push from that.
Yeah, so in the end, you could be a kind of a trusted third party for reputation data.
Yeah, that's our ultimate goal,
right? The reputation, I guess.
Yeah, the reputation standard.
Yeah.
And what's interesting is that we're not only seeing this in, you know, the sharing economy, but it's also going into landlord and tenants, it's going into insurance, credit ratings, even company review sites have contacted us, and a lot of them have criticism against fake reviews about companies. But so can we help, you know, combat fake reviews on those sites by saying, okay, well, here's trustworthy users and so on. So the application is quite widespread. But obviously, we're born out of the sharing economy or into it. I don't know. But so that's our focus right now. But there are definitely more applications going forward.
And if you look at the map of the world,
yeah.
which part of the world are most interesting for you? Because I guess, to make quick wits, you can go to the more developed countries because they're already using platforms, so it's quite easy or doable to start over there.
Yeah.
But in the less developed worlds, parts of the world, it's maybe even a more added value because they don't have all the existing data, especially when you're going to look for credit checks for insurance or for loans.
Yeah. There's good points, and I think that's also a testament to, you know, already from when we started, we had early customer interest, and that came from around the world. So I think we have leads in our pipeline, at least right now, over 30 different countries in all continents. So we haven't until now sort of had a focused approach. We sort of lived off of inbounds. But now we're actually, we did an initial test in the Netherlands, which was really positive because it's very close to the Danish market as well. You're very developed in terms of the sharing economy. But we are looking more towards the UK just because there's a lot more startups, there's a lot more investment, and the legislation is quite liberal as well. So they don't seem to be the startups we meet there are not under so much pressure from the government as mm-hmm. we hear, for example, in Denmark or at least other Nordic countries. Yeah. So right now it's UK that's the focus, and then we'll see. But US is obviously always an interesting market because it's so big.
Yes. Yeah. Like your brother said, I also was in Israel.
Yeah.
And they all say we're not developing things for our country.
No.
We're developing everything for the US
yeah.
because the market.
Yeah.
But it's also, yeah, it's got some pros and some cons, of course.
Yeah.
And. But in fact, I think what is one of the biggest issues we're seeing right now is that governments are facilitating us as people who are living in a country with a offline identity.
Mm-hmm.
We've got our passport, and with that we can prove we are who we say we are. But they are not offering us a digital identity.
Mm-hmm.
I also went to Estonia.
Yeah.
I think that it's really interesting what they're doing. I think what they need to change is they need to get the name Estonia out of the system and think of another name.
Yeah.
But how do you see that governments also in the future maybe can get more into the digital identity, because then it will also be much easier for you to create a better product, because mm-hmm. now you're using Facebook.
Yeah.
And of course it's the best option that's available, but I think that's the ideal option.
It's the best scalable option, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Especially internationally, because Facebook is in every country.
Yeah.
So what would be your ideal picture if you say, okay, this is my
what happens in that space? Yeah. So ID verification is a whole different business, and there are some really cool startups doing stuff in that space. And ideally, I mean, in Denmark we have something called NemID, which is the online version of what you're referring to in Estonia. We could have integrated with that, it's open, but the thing is it's not scalable, right? So it doesn't make sense for us to verify, you know, we have what maybe a million potential users in Denmark, that's not big enough. So that's why we're saying, okay, well, social media, and then we cross-reference there.
Yeah.
Last week I was in Oslo for the Digital North Conference, and they were talking a lot about the e-signature or an online identity that goes across the Baltics and the Nordics. And I think that's a really interesting perspective and something that would help us and also our users. But you know, when you know how slow governments work, it's probably not feasible for us to calculate that would be ready next year and that it's something that will make sense for us to integrate at this point. But naturally, and I mean, we can also feed the other way if that's an option at some point, right? So we're open to discussing this with any governments that are interested in learning how we see online identity.
Yeah. But first, it's a more long-term project, and second, it only works for you when it's a scalable option.
Yeah.
So like when the whole EU would adapt the same
system. Yes.
I think there's also other discussion, but this is also one of the biggest quick wins the EU can make by the benefit of working together with other countries.
Exactly.
But I also don't think it will happen the next
20
years.
you're probably right, yeah.
And if you... How are things going right now with the platform? So, or with the service? How are you? Because in which year did you launch?
In which countries, you mean?
In which year?
Oh, last year.
Last year.
Yes.
So it's quite a young company.
Quite a young company, and we're still, trying to run as fast as we can with limited resources. Just because you get one investment, that also runs out at one point. It's going really well. We're seeing a lot of interest. We sort of rolled out the last part of the product in March, but we're now getting people onboarded, and we're seeing that it works really well, and that's super interesting. And that's also why we're looking to, okay, we sort of handled the inbounds that we're getting, and now we want to make a more focused effort towards, now we've chosen the UK, but
and are you also planning bringing additional data sources to the platform that you can use?
As I said before, we're negotiating with Uber, BlaBlaCar, Couchsurfing, we've been in touch with as well. So the more bigger platforms that we're seeing working on their APIs, we're actually talking to them. And if anyone's interested in opening up for us, they can just get in touch.
Yeah.
We're doing as much as we can, and you know, the more we apply our API somewhere, the more data we also get back into the system.
Yeah, and system, how much more data you have, how much more you can learn.
Exactly.
If you know how to deal with it well, that's also always the challenge.
Of course, and that's also, you know, we're building part of our product is we have a little bit of statistics in the back end that platforms can actually see, so they can look at how their ratings and reviews are distributed across users, and that's something that we really want to develop and help them look into what is the data analytics and the business intelligence part of their platform and how can they optimize. But right now that's not a main priority because we have limited resources.
Yes, and I think also one added value for the big platforms like BlaBlaCar, I also interviewed both founders. And the last one, the last interview, we also talked about the newbie effect, because I also said, okay, why the hell should you work together with other services like Deemly, because you want to own everything yourself? And say, yeah, first we that was our opinion, but then we also learned that now we have a really dedicated small user base, and they're gaining many good recommendations. But people who are new on the platform, they have a problem because they start at zero.
Exactly.
So for them, it's also a extra incentive to think about how to work together.
And I think that's a really interesting point, and something that we hear from a lot of the smaller platforms also saying, yeah, we might be, you know, sharing data with our competitors through a third party, but it also means that we're much stronger when we look together towards our big competitors. So we work with a couple of small sort of house sharing platforms, and they say, well, if we go together and put our efforts into growing together, then we're much stronger against Airbnb, for example. So that's an interesting sort of perspective on sharing, and something that you don't see in any other industries where, you know, people don't share their data in that sense.
Yeah, really cool. And I also think that will be the first time that sharing platforms will share something themselves.
Yeah.
Because they're just like every other startup, really internal focused. Think, okay, maybe we can do it, but then but only when we are much bigger.
Yeah.
And when you're looking at the future of trust and the value of trust, we had already some discussion about it online, because from my perspective, what I think is that the peer-to-peer trust systems are really valuable also on long term.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the value is now is biggest because now we need to go to do things that we have never done before.
Mm-hmm.
There's a famous story about Airbnb, which idiots is going to fly to the other part of the world and sleep together, or not together, but in the same house with a complete stranger.
Yeah.
And I think the peer-to-peer trust really helps them to get over the barrier and to do it. But on the long term, people are going to trust also the brand of Airbnb.
Yeah.
And what I also see, that's something from the e-commerce background, especially with things you're doing like every day or on a more regular basis, that's like me as a person, I got a little bit reference tired. When I bought something in a web shop and I get the email, oh, do you want to rate us?
Yeah.
No, sorry. So yeah. I throw them away. Only with really big important things, like when I'm selling my house and I need to give her a rating about the broker, then I take time for it. But in the most daily activities, I think that's too much hassle at the start of it.
Yeah.
Am I too negative?
No, I think what's interesting, you know, compared to e-commerce is that the rating is both ways, right? So I think there's an internal driver in all of us that says, well, I'm kind of curious what you think about me. So if I want to know, because a lot of them are what you call blind ratings, right? So I can't see what you rate me unless I rate you. And then so you're curious about what people think about you and how you were perceived. That's just a mechanism in our vanity, I guess. So in that sense, there's sort of an internal motivation for us to actually rate each other. So I'll give you a rating and then I can see what you think about me.
Yeah.
But I think it's important that, you know, those ratings keep being trustworthy, of course. And that's probably also the issue with the products and the companies that you're reviewing. I lost my train of thought.
So you think even the balance between trust and peer-to-peer and trust from brands will change, but not drastically that the peer-to-peer trust will go to 1.0 and the brand trust goes to 99.9?
Well, if you look at the sharing economy as an industry as a whole, what I usually talk about is there are sort of three levels of trust, right? So there's the overall trust for a user for the sharing economy. Do I think this is a concept that I believe in? Should I stay in an Airbnb rather than a hotel? That's sort of something that you can only decide for yourself. But also what the government says, right? Is this even legal and so on? Then the second level is more about, do I trust the company? So what if something goes wrong? Do they have 24-hour support? Do they have insurance? There are even, you know, rating sites coming up specifically for sharing economy businesses now, looking at how trustworthy the business is as a whole. And then the third level is the peer-to-peer trust. So I don't think that you can separate those. It's trust is a really complex topic, and it always has been in e-commerce as well, but even more so now when you're interacting with strangers and in a environment where legislation isn't always clear as well.
But maybe on long term, it will be that will still be important, but not so much on the foreground, or that is more a check mechanism. It's also really interesting in industries where we don't really know if it's all allowed. But this will change in the next 5 years, because they will be shut down or they will grow up. Maybe something same like when I'm using the train, or I'm here with the metro, with the bus, and I didn't check the reputation score of the driver because I thought, okay, I believe in the system that it works. So maybe it can also play a role in the more behind the scenes check processes. Then people don't need to think about it all the time.
I think that's definitely one way that it could go. I think an interesting point in connection to that is that the Federal Trade Commission in the US last year published a report on how peer-to-peer rating and review systems can actually help alleviate the need for legislation because it's a peer police system. So in one way, you know, in a utopian fantasy, maybe we don't even need rules for sharing economy platforms because we just work it out ourselves. And I think that's an interesting thought, and that really shows how much power and value our interactions have and how we assess the value of that interaction.
And also in the, because you're relying on data from others, so it's really hard to make changes in the trust mechanism yourself because you need, so that's maybe also something. The way I'm asking is I also did an interview with a meeting review. It's a small platform or a website in the Netherlands. You can review meeting spaces, and that sounds quite boring when I first heard of them. But then they told me about the system. They got some really nice techniques built in their rating system, because one of the things I say sometimes about reputation and rating is that it doesn't allow you to make mistakes, because you know, okay, when I make a mistake, then I don't have as much work tomorrow and today. But how do we learn as individuals by making mistakes? So what they did is say, okay, a score you have is will keep it for 5 years, and every year the value of the score lowers with 20% in our calculation. So after the first year, we only calculated with 80%, 60, 20, to zero. And they also open a system where you can change your rating. Because a rating is also a way of giving feedback. Maybe then the supply can do something to make the customer happy again, and then also the rating can be changed. So these are two really interesting things they have implemented into their system. But that's of course the problem you have is that you can't change the rating mechanism from the customers, or can you?
No, not at the moment. Unless it's, we can't change the data that comes in. We can only, if they use our rating system, obviously we will have some best principle in terms of our technology and what's doable. And a lot of the work that we do with the platforms is also advising on what is best practices and how should you be doing this, and what is the most responsible way to handle this. And I think the changing in And rating is an interesting fact. I know that Airbnb has been discussing that as well, but they then allow people to actually comment on it. I think that might be a better option. but yeah, this is something that we'll keep following, and any good principles and experiences, I'd love to hear about them and talk, because this is constantly developing. And it's really interesting.
And if you look at the way that you're getting the data from the platform, are you logging in every month, or is there something that you can share on camera?
Yeah, so every API that we have access to is a little different. But we do need to have the users log in. We don't store that, but we need that to pull the data. And then we update that every 24 hours, for the biggest one at least. So we don't store the passwords, and it's not something that we intend to do, but we just need it. So we don't scrape anything. A lot of people think that we just go out and scrape all your data and then we give you some kind of score. That's not how it works.
And it depends on the platform, how the data is presented to the API.
Yeah, yes.
Because in the most ideal situation, the example I gave from 180, 60, 40, 20, 0% in 5 years, then you could also do that yourself if you would get only the new ratings.
Yeah, so our algorithm right now takes account that newer ratings weigh more than older ratings. So we sort of have a similar, I'm not sure about the percentages, but I can look that up. I think
And your business model? Also not really also important.
Yes, so we charge a monthly subscription fee to the platforms based on whether they use both the API or the rating system. Right now it's based on how many users they have, because that obviously takes a toll on our system and how we use it. So that's fairly simple. And then we see more revenue streams and applications down the line. So I think for the startups, we have a very, very fair pricing. And for bigger other applications, we see a much bigger potential for revenue. But right now, a lot of the sharing economy is small, and we know that. But our goal is to get as many on board, of course, as possible.
And looking to the future, because I think there are two scenarios for the platform economy, sharing economy for the future, and one of the two scenarios is really interesting for you. The first one is that all the platforms grow big monopolies, and that there is no place for smaller platforms.
Yep.
So that would be a really bad situation for you.
Yeah.
Other one is that there will be much more small local platforms, and I really believe there's an opportunity for that. Because when you look at sharing economy, most of the times, except Airbnb, but most of the times, the transaction is local.
Yeah.
So demand and supply, they're all in the same area.
Yes.
Like Snapcar, the Dutch car sharing platform, it's nice they want to be the biggest in Europe, but I will never cycle for more than 5 minutes to get a shared car.
No, exactly.
So that gives much opportunities for the more local platforms. Yeah. What do you, because I've also been involved in some platform co-op conferences where like taxi drivers are investing themselves in their own app.
Yeah.
It's a nice example of Green Taxi in Denver.
Yeah.
Everybody using this example because there are no other or not so many other interesting examples already on the market.
Mm-hmm.
But what do you think do you need for such a scenario? Because I think for Dimly it would be really interesting, because it would be impossible for all the different small local platforms to organize the rating and reputation themselves. But what are your thoughts about that?
Yeah, I think both scenarios are sort of true, and it's also what we're seeing now, that there are these, maybe a handful or 10 global major players, but there's, thousands and thousands of mid-tier and tiny local platforms. And I see that we can bring value no matter how big the size is of the platform. So far, I'm not really worried if that's what your question is.
No, it's not a question. I'm just curious about your vision.
I think that the sharing economy will grow, and I think that in 10 years we won't call it the sharing economy. It's just how we do business and how we live our lives. So in that sense, this becomes more and more integrated and part of your online activity. you know, you might also connect it to your social media account even more and how you interact. So I do believe that there is a market for very local startups. As you say, they're just some of the products or things that we share that it doesn't make sense that it's, you know, a global US dominant player that facilitates your bike share in Amsterdam, right?
Yeah. Looking forward. And what are your now, at this moment, your biggest challenge?
Well, we really want to scale, right? And we have all this interest and also some potential new revenue streams. We have a lot of partnerships that we want to run after. So it's basically a question of resources but I think that's the case for any entrepreneur and startup. Where do you focus your efforts when you have limited resources? And you know, there are lots of things that we can do to the product that would make it even more helpful and useful for the platforms and the users. That's something that we're continuously working on. So I think it's a question of resources. And then obviously that the legislation and the governments around, especially Europe, sort of wake up and realize that this is happening and they need to legislate or leave us alone in a way, right? Not us, but our customers. Obviously.
No, leave us alone. I think it's good.
All of us in the sharing economy.
I think it would be a good thing if we just do a roundtable session with you, with Joel van ShareTribe, the open source marketplace software, and some guys from the Estonia platform. And maybe we can do something to make the big ambition happen, because it won't happen in Brussels.
No, exactly. I think at Digital North, when I did the panel there, they were very curious and open to understanding it. The problem is, and I said this at one point, like I hope that no one in this room actually legislates on the sharing economy without having tried it. And people laughed because they know it was true, right? A lot of them had never tried. They might have tried Airbnb on a holiday, but none of the other platforms. And that's a shame, right? You shouldn't be legislating on things that you basically don't understand.
Yeah, I think it's a really basic rule, but I think everybody who is busy with this subject forgets.
Yeah, that's exactly. Pretty. But it's about being humble about, you know, what do we know and what don't we know about the sharing economy.
So really know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
Cool.
Or ask people.
Right. Okay, great.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Let's do another interview in a year.
Yeah.
Because what you say, you're just live now for a year. I think lots of cool stuff happened. So I'm looking forward to hear what your next steps will be.
Yes. Come back. See the office.
I will.
Thank you so much.